coming up. The full story from Anaheim on the Saints blowout of Los Angeles. We'll talk to the Cajun Cannon about what may be the best season of his career. We'll also get personal with one of his favorite targets, wide receiver Quinn Early. Plus, we'll get you in the holiday spirit as we take you exclusively to the Saints Players Christmas Party.
That's what I'm the baby.
It's all smiles on Saints Sideline. Next.
Saints Sideline. Brought to you by Midas. Nobody beats Midas. Nobody. Your local Isuzu dealers. Budweiser. Nothing beats Saints football and nothing beats a Bud. And by Lennox. It must be a Lennox.
This is an exclusive presentation of WGNO Sports. Ed Daniels. Alexander Laurent. Saints Sideline.
Hello, thank you for joining us on Saints Sideline. I'm Alexander Laurent.
And I'm Ed Daniels.
And the Saints played their most complete game offensively and defensively of the year in L.A. It was a picture-perfect performance.
And a good time for them to hit their peak. The playoffs are just 3 weeks away. The Rams never had a chance on Sunday. The Saints controlled the line of scrimmage on offense and defense and cruised to a 37-14 win.
Saints broke the Rams' spirit with two big defensive plays in the first quarter. Rickey Jackson's hit forced Cleveland Gary's fumble, recovered by Sam Mills and turned into six, and a 12-yard touchdown pass from Bobby Hebert to Eric Martin. Then the Rams playing first and 10 at the Saints 17. Toi Cook picked off Jim Everett.
He didn't seem that frustrated, maybe because we were up 30 points, you know. They were concentrating more on just, you know, getting first downs, trying to make it not a blowout and as respectable as possible. I think at one point, you know, when we were up 20 to nothing, then we went 27, you know, the fire kind of went out of his eyes.
Another 80-yard drive and an Hebert 16-yard flip to Torrance Small, plus an Anderson field goal made it 23-0. By half, the Saints had 14 first downs, 237 total yards.
We didn't expect to totally dominate offensively like we did, but, you know, we'll take it.
Only a pair of touchdowns by the Rams at garbage time made the score look just a little bit better. The Saints looked like a team pleased, but not overjoyed. There's bigger fish to fry.
Well, we got a better team than them. I mean, you can see that, and everybody know that. And Saints always be prepared. Coach Mark keep us prepared, and that's the thing. I mean, this team go out and play one way that's good, hard, fundamental football, and try not to make too many mistakes.
The Rams were coming off one of the greatest comebacks in team history. Last week, they rallied from 24 points down to beat Tampa Bay. But as sports writers covering the Rams were quick to point out, the Saints are not the Bucks. Here's what they're saying. The Los Angeles Times' Tin Kawakami writes, eager for a sequel to one of their most scintillating efforts in years, the Rams on Sunday fell a little short. Short of talent, short of patience, short of just about everything it takes to beat the New Orleans Saints, who took the Rams six turnovers and varied assortment of other errors and turned them into 37 consecutive points. The Times' Mike Penner was not exactly enamored with the Rams' play Sunday, writing, desperately seeking a tourniquet, the Rams instead merely ran up the cutlery metaphors. They forked the ball over six times. They spoon-fed the New Orleans Saints 37 points. They were sliced and diced, carved and skewered, and finally served up on a silver platter. Rack of Ram, barbecued Cajun style.
Quinn Early caught two passes for 44 yards Sunday. Not his best numbers this year, but another solid performance. 1992 has clearly been the best year of his career. As Doug Mouton shows us, he's emerged as a legitimate deep threat.
Confidence is a wonderful thing for a professional athlete to have, and right now Quinn Early has an awful lot of it.
I think the fact that I've been here, you know, going on 2 years now, and I think that I'm more confident with the offense and with Bobby as a quarterback. I think he's more confident with me as a receiver. You know, he knows that if he puts the ball down there, you know, I can make the play. And I think that Carl Smith, who's the offensive coordinator, I think he has confidence in me. You know, let's get Quinn down the field. Let's try to put the ball up. You know, let's get a big gain here. And, you know, I think that since things have worked, you know, when we have put the ball down the field, I think that all three of us have become more confident, and which makes, I think, the offense a little better.
Quinn Early's role in the offense is the deep threat, the guy who stretches the defense to help open up stuff underneath for the other receivers, especially Eric Martin. It's the first time in his career that Early has this role.
And Quinn Early has the numbers to back that up this year. In his four previous NFL seasons, he had averaged 14.7 yards a catch. This year, he's nearly 5 yards better.
What that means is that number 89 is getting up the field. He's the most valuable player the Saints picked up in the now-defunct Plan B system. He came over from San Diego, where somehow the Chargers had given up on him.
The rumor was that, I don't know how true this rumor is, because it didn't sound right, but that he was the slowest receiver they had. So that's why they let him go, and I'm saying there's no way. I mean, I know the Anthony Miller, they got guys who can fly, but I said if Quinn was the slowest receiver they had, that, you know, that's unbelievable. You know, where he didn't fit in there, maybe, you know, he fits in great for us.
I've been in the league 5 years now, and it seems like I've been working so hard these past 5 years, and I've never gotten the recognition. And I think now, you know, finally some of my hard work is paying off.
Doug Mouton, Saints Sideline.
Up next, the Saints have a new player rep. We'll ask Jim Dombrowski about his new responsibilities.
And Bobby Hebert is on a roll. We'll hear from a rejuvenated Cajun cannon when Saints Sideline continues. The Saints have a new representative to the Players Association. Hobie Brenner has stepped down, and taking over as player rep is guard Jim Dombrowski.
When Hobie decided that he wanted to step down and you guys were trying to figure out who they wanted to replace him, a bunch of them came up and asked me if I was interested, and I said, yeah, you know, I'll give it a try. And I don't plan on doing it as long as Hobie did. Hobie did it for 10 years. I'm just going to take it a year by year. I'm going to see what exactly it entails and whether or not I like it. If I don't like it at the end of this year, I'm going to step down. But if I like it, I'll continue.
Of course, the big item facing Dombrowski and the Players Association is getting a new collective bargaining agreement.
The settlement of several lawsuits could postpone that agreement. One of them involves Saints quarterback Bobby Hebert. Hebert hasn't let the lawsuit affect his performance on the field as he continues to play the best football of his career.
In 1992, Bobby Hebert is taking his play up another notch or two. Example, the Saints trailing late against Atlanta. Hebert makes a great throw, Eric Martin a better catch. Morton Anderson comes in, Saints win. Example, against Miami. Under heavy pressure, Hebert shows mobility, throws on the run to Martin for 17 yards. Later in the same drive, Hebert makes a perfect throw to Quinn Early, setting up a Dalton Hilliard touchdown.
I really believe that I'm, you know, in the top 10. Compare, you know, wins and losses with other quarterbacks, you know, things that I've done compared with them, who's supposedly the better quarterback.
This week's Pro Football Weekly rated the quarterbacks. Maybe you'll get no argument for the top 9, but after that, take a look at 10 through 14. Everett, Esiason, Kozar, Harbaugh, Sims, all ahead of Bobby Hebert. Hebert won 45 of the 65 games he started his last five seasons, a winning mark of 70%.
I get a lot of respect from football people who are in and day out, other coaches coming up to me, other general managers who are really making decisions for other teams or who's on their team or not, and they have me up there, so, I mean, that's pleasing to me more than the public perception of what they think.
Playing in one of the league's smallest TV markets and playing with a team yet to flex its muscle in the playoffs doesn't help Hebert's rating. If he takes the Saints deep into the postseason, media and fans nationwide may discover what Bobby Hebert already knows.
Up next, it's time for some holiday cheer. We'll take you exclusively to the Saints Christmas party when Saints Sideline continues. We have a lot to celebrate this holiday season with an 11-3 record and having clinched a playoff berth. So they took a little time last week to let loose at the annual Players Christmas Party. It's the Players' annual Christmas party, a time to get together with teammates and family to enjoy some good food and good times. Bobby Hebert and Gene Acton showed up with the same shirt on.
How did it happen that you two guys have the same shirt on?
My wife.
What happened, Bobby?
My wife dresses me.
It being that special time of the year, I wondered what the players wanted for Christmas and what they were really getting.
I saw a nice bomber jacket, got Bugs Bunny on the back, and I'm kind of a big Looney Tunes fan, so I kind of like that.
Some white Hanes underwear and black socks to go with it.
Blah, blah, blah.
Well, I don't want anything that special. I just, you know, hope and pray that Teresa don't spend all my money.
Actually, I already bought it. It's a pair of orange boxer shorts from The Gap. They have little coats and ties on them. They're great. I bought it a few days ago, but don't tell him.
Okay.
What do you want for Christmas, man?
Well, it's something I really, really need. My son Patrick needs a playmate, mother. Excuse me, Robin.
Can you be honest? A pair of socks.
I tell you what. I like maybe a new pair of shoes.
Well, I have not decided yet, but my daughter thinks he needs another Porsche, so maybe another Porsche.
Alexander, I'm so glad you asked me that question. I was up late last night, 2 o'clock, watching the shopping channel. And I was just thinking, there's this thing on about the Chia Pet, you know? 1995, 2-for-1 deal.
Well, you know, I mean, he wanted a Carrera, but I said no, he's gonna get a Chia Pet.
Oh, what I want for Christmas? Jim Feeks to smile. Just once. That's all.
What am I getting him for Christmas?
A football.
I want a camera, a bicycle, and some smoke neck bone.
Probably a camera and a leather jacket, and I don't know what else.
I want a bionic knee for Christmas.
Are they expensive?
I don't care what they cost. I mean, the $6 million man costs $6 million for his whole body. I just want a bionic knee. It's less than $6 million.
Maybe a Santa Claus suit or a long beard, maybe with a black mustache. How does that sound?
Wow.
Well, I thought long and hard about this, and, you know, Toi's like a big animal lover, and I'm thinking a pot-bellied pig would be something he would just enjoy.
What do you want? What do you want? I'd like some peace and harmony. Some peace, some peace, some peace and harmony.
Anaheim Stadium has been a very hospitable place for the Saints in recent years. You might say it's the Saints' home away from home. Difficult economic times have Californians leaving their state in growing numbers. But for the Saints, they're still the California dream. Six straight wins out at Anaheim make this the Saints' home away from home. Stanford alum Toi Cook was more into reality than dreaming, knowing the Rams would not come back against the Saints as they did against the Tampa Bay Bucks.
It was mentioned, and I said on the sidelines, that as soon as we got in at halftime, there would be talk of last week against Tampa. Reggie Jones said the difference is we're not Tampa's defense. we had a really good feel of what they wanted to do offensively, and we knew that we'd go out and shut them down.
It's at the point of the season where it's time to play those type of games, and hey, what a great time for it.
He'll run it. They call Anaheim the Big A, a grade the Saints score here six straight years.
The Saints win another one at Anaheim Stadium!
Up next, more from Sunday's rout of the Rams.
And we'll go back 11 years to another Ram tough performance. Stay with us for more of Saints Sideline. Back
scored touchdowns in the win over the Rams, but not the one who's been the most productive. It was definitely an eventful day for Saints running backs.
The Saints ran for 161 yards, the toughest one, a second quarter touchdown, sending Fred McAfee to the sidelines with a separated shoulder.
Just going for the goal line, and I guess somebody hit me, or maybe the ground or something caused it. But I just felt a lot of pain in my shoulder. And Stan Brock came over to help me up, and I tried to push up, and I couldn't. So I was like, I must be hurt.
Craig Hayward's 9-yard touchdown run will cost him $1,500. The price for being chipper can be steep, and steep the hill's been recently for Vaughn Dunar. Rookie number one pick who helped himself back in the running picture with 91 yards on 13 carries.
Especially for running backs, they let me know that, hey, it's different in college, and I'm definitely learning that. You have to take your lumps, and once you get another chance, prove that you're worthy of, being back there.
In 6 games, the Rams have not beaten the Saints this decade. 4 times, Jim Mora has swept L.A. Before Mora, it happened only once, back in 1981, as we see in this week's Great Games in Saints History. 1981, the first year under O.A. Bum Phillips. Bum was trying to turn around a team that was an NFL worst 1-15 the year before, and he did it with rookies. 6 rookies were starters on defense, and they played a big part in the sweep of the Rams. In Game 1 in the Superdome, rookie free agent Frank Watlett came up with this key interception, while veteran Eloy Scrooms, number 78, kept the pressure on Ram quarterbacks. On the offensive side, the Saints were getting all the bounces, as here, wide receiver Wes Chandler makes the fumble recovery in stride, and the Saints won their first game under Bum Phillips, 23-17. In the second meeting, 8 weeks later at Anaheim, the defense held L.A. to just 1 touchdown. Rookie defensive end Jim Wilkes led the charge. And the Saints' offense ran wild. Here, rookie quarterback Dave Wilson scrambles and hits rookie tight end Hobie Brenner. But it was the running game that was the difference. As a team, New Orleans rushed 52 times for 307 yards. That's still the most in a single game in team history. And the Saints won 21-13. In those victories over the Rams, the most impressive rookie was running back George Rogers. The Heisman Trophy winner gained 323 yards and 4 touchdowns as the Saints swept L.A. for the first time in team history. Still ahead on Saints Sideline, we'll update the Saints' position in the playoff picture and look ahead to Sunday's battle with the AFC champions. The 49er magic number for winning the NFC West is just 1 after they beat the Vikings Sunday. That means San Francisco needs to win just 1 more game or have the Saints lose once, and the Niners are the division champs. The Saints' only hope is to win twice and hope the 49ers lose twice. Wade Wilson got his first start in Atlanta and threw 5 touchdown passes as the Falcons ran over Tampa Bay 35-7. They're now 6-8. The Rams fall to 5-9 after the loss to the Saints. San Francisco will host Tampa Bay and Detroit in the final 2 weeks of the season. If they win both games, they'll have the home field advantage throughout the playoffs. The Minnesota Vikings have now lost 3 of their last 5 games, but still lead the Central at 9-5. And the Cowboys are still on top in the East, despite a loss to Washington Sunday. If the Saints win Sunday against the Bills, they'll host a first-round playoff game. The Redskins have won 3 in a row since losing to the Saints. They're now 9-5. The Eagles are next after winning in overtime over Seattle Sunday. The Eagles and the Redskins will fight it out this Sunday. The winner will probably play the Saints in the Superdome in the first round of the playoffs. Meanwhile, the Green Bay Packers continue to stay close. The Pack beat Houston Sunday night to move to 8-6.
The Saints defense will get a good test Sunday when Jim Kelly, Thurman Thomas, and the AFC champion Buffalo Bills come to the Dome. The Bills and Saints last played on a snow-covered field in December of 1989. John McForcade making his first start in over 2 years. Hit John Tice for the score, and the Saints led early. Later, Forcade was all fired up through the screen pass to Dalton Hilliard. Hilliard caught it, weaved his way through the snow and the Bills. Forcade through for over 300 yards as the Saints held on to win 22-19. Alex, Jim Kelly intercepted three times in that game, December of 1989. I think for the Bills in recent history, that was a low point. Of course, after that, 1990 and 91, the Buffalo Bills went on to the Super Bowl.
You know, the Bills really need a win Sunday. They're trying to hold off Miami in the AFC East, so they will be ready. And that showdown is noon in the Superdome.
But before that, don't forget to watch the final edition of Friday Night Football. Coach J.T. Curtis and I will recap an incredible season in Louisiana high school football. That's Friday night at 10:30 right here on WGNO 26. I'm Ed Daniels.
I'm Alexander LaRocque. We'll see you next week on Saints Sideline.
Saints Sideline.